Welcome, welcome. Some very important ground to cover here, so let's get right to it. It is essential that those have made right use of time, that they accept the benefits of this, to set an example for the rest of those who need to use time a little more wisely in the future. So that is the essential message. I urge everyone to accept the maximum benefits that accrue to them through the right use of time. We learn through role models, those who set good examples for us. And when imagine when somebody wants to use time rightly in this world, it's very stressful, very difficult, but it's also very necessary. And they're going to say, okay, what's the benefit to me? What's the payoff? Why should I do this? And they're going to look to see, is there anybody that's done this right use of time, and what were the benefits? And if they see, somebody did use time rightly and they benefited greatly, look at the wonderful benefits, they say, wow, I want that. I'm going to put up with the difficulty. I'm going to climb that mountain. They want to know, what do you get when you get to the top of the mountain? Why should I climb the mountain, you see? Whereas, let's say someone climbs the top of the mountain and then they say, I don't want any benefits, forget it. And they throw all the benefits away. What happens then? People look and say, why should I climb the mountain? What is that? It's only to, I'll only throw the benefits away. I get nothing for doing it, so I'm not going to even start. It's folly. It's only for fools. So it is of the highest importance. It's a complete obligation for those who use their time rightly to accept the benefits, the maximum benefits from doing this. It is a total obligation. It's obligation beyond any other obligation. And so this is where we're at right now. So this is what I'm looking at, and I need to urge everybody in the world to accept the benefits they possibly can from their usage of time, to set positive examples for everyone else. That is the way it needs to go. And so that's what came to me this morning. I feel I've used time very well, and I need to accept the benefits from doing so. To set the right example. I cannot dampen down the benefits. Like, let me accept the very minimum. And people say, well, I'm not going to spend an entire lifetime of tremendous stress and difficulty for just peanuts. Why should I do that? Doesn't make any sense, does it? Whereas if I get the maximum benefits, tremendous benefits, they'll say, wow, how come you got those? I say, right use of time. And you can have the same benefits if you use your time wisely. And they'll think, say, hey, and they'll get motivation. You get motivation from seeing success of others. You say, I want that success. So I need to put in the hard work to get that success. I need to use time, right use of mind, right use of time. I need to do that. So it's incumbent upon me to accept the benefits of my use of time, which I believe has been quite good. And the benefits could be quite extraordinary, quite great benefits. Okay, now we got that out of the way. We will build upon that. Remember, the only problem we have is the continuity problem, and right use of time will help you see that. Right use of time will help you see how the continuity problem is solved. It's not by making dreams real and then triumphing over them. For instance, making death real and triumphing over death, or defeating death, or no, it's by accepting the blessing upon all dreams, regardless of content, with nothing excluded. In other words, God saying, blessing of non-judgment, saying, no, dreams don't need to be judged. They're totally inconsequential. Whew. We say, we don't need to triumph over anything. We don't need to change anything in the dream. Don't need to do anything about the dreams at all. Just accept the blessing. That solves the continuity problem. And we can recognize we don't need to dream at all. Reality doesn't require dreams. So part of what we all have to do on the path is to correct mistakes. How do we correct mistakes? By identifying mistakes. First we have to see them. Then we say, I think that's a mistake. And then we say, okay, now how do I correct that mistake? That's just basic learning. So I made a mistake in way back in some videos way back. I say death must die. I may have used that phrase. I think I did. No, death must die. No, that's wrong. That's wrong. That's entirely wrong, actually. So let me correct that. We don't have to triumph over death at all. Absolutely not. In fact, that's the opposite. That's like saying we need to triumph over cancer. That's the idea of overcoming some dream, some part of the dream. Let's overcome it. Let's overcome sickness. Let's overcome death. Overcoming something in the dream is the false path. That's the wrong path. That's what causes you to embrace whatever it is you want to overcome. So we're embracing death, saying, come here, death, I want to grapple with you. Whereas we say, I don't need to overcome death. Let it go. Let it go. And it seems to evaporate because you're not pulling it towards you in a condensed manner so you can get a hold of it. Just like any sickness, the same thing. We don't need to overcome anything. We only need to see a dream that overlays all dreams equally. A dream that doesn't exclude any dreams at all and does not evaluate, doesn't judge content at all. That's all we need. So we only need to accept that blessing upon all of dreams, including the dreaming of death, sickness, impermanence, everything. We don't need to overcome anything. Don't need to overcome anything. So I was able to see that this morning. I said, well, wait a minute. I don't have to kill death. I don't have to kill. Death doesn't have to die. I don't have to kill it. Not at all. It's the opposite. We don't have to triumph over anything. Because what need does reality have to triumph over dreams? And we are... We never left reality. We need to realize we never left. So that's why the continuity issue is the only issue we have. We need to realize we never left, and we dreams are meaningless. They are completely inconsequential to reality, totally inconsequential. So we don't need to try to make death real and then defeat it or kill it. No, just the opposite. Let it go. Don't try to triumph over it. It's just as inconsequential as any other. It's as inconsequential as dreams of life. Dreams of life, dreams of death, dreams of wellness, dreams of sickness, they're all equally inconsequential. Don't have to embrace any of it. And with that realization, you abide in the blessed dream, the vision of non-judgment, the overlay, the vision of oneness, non-exclusion. Right here, right now, no exception. Your awareness is aware of that. That's the benefit from right use of time, where nothing is bothersome because you're not trying to overcome anything. Where is death when we're not trying to overcome it? It's nowhere. Because it's our desire to overcome death that makes it appear. How can we overcome something that doesn't appear? See, that's the way to look at it. How can we overcome something if it doesn't appear at all? So in dreams, how do we overcome something? We dream something up. You say, I want to overcome some sickness. And then, oh, there's the sickness. Oh my God, there it is. Now I'm going to get that sucker. And I'm going to overcome, I'm going to defeat it. I'm going to kill that cancer. Same with death. We say we want to overcome death. So death appears for us, you see. And actually the origin of all this dreaming was the desire to become prime creator and then that necessitate the annihilation of reality, actually, because reality is one indivisible whole. We'd have to change reality to be prime creator. And that then we say, oh my gosh, how do we overcome that annihilation? So we said we need to defeat the annihilation. And we symbolize the annihilation of reality by death. So we're dreaming. We say, we need to defeat death. So where is death? Well, let's make it up. Let's imagine it. That's what we did. We've imagined all of this. So death is just imaginary, entirely imaginary. But it's our desire to defeat it that makes it seem real to us, that makes it keep appearing, makes it keep appearing. If we don't want to defeat anything, why should any trouble appear? Anything that needs to be overcome appear to us. It won't. It won't because we're just dreaming all of it. So this is crucial. And I saw that this morning. I said, oh, wow. That is great. It just fits in perfectly with what we've been talking about. Except the blessing of non-judgment upon all dreams. And that everything that you're experiencing will be simply delightful. Delightful, because you will not be experiencing anything that you from a motive of overcoming it. Why do we need to overcome something that's delightful? We don't. We're only trying to overcome something that's terrible, right? We want to really overcome something that's bad. So it's pretty simple, and Right Use of Time lays it out clearly. And so the benefits of right use of time are likely to be quite exceptional in my case, simply through right use of time. It's the same for anyone, but I need to show that other people need to see that, hey, if you use time rightly, you will really get free of suffering. You really have tremendous benefits from that. That's the obligation. I'm under this obligation, which is difficult because the world imposes all sorts of obligations upon all of us. And I have to say, no, look, this one trumps all those obligations. It truly does. It truly does. So also I have the right to hang out with those who have also accepted the vision of non-judgment. I have the right to hang out with them, to see them, access to them. I should, absolutely. I should avail myself of that. That's a benefit. You know, welcome to the club. In other words, have the members, club membership, and all the privileges of club membership, as it were. I have to avail myself of that too, so people can say, well, hey, I want to get in that club. And I say, okay, just right use of time in your next cycle. And of course, you keep cycling. Why? Why do we have cycles of incarnation over and over? Because we want to keep defeating something. We want to keep overcoming something. That's why. We want to overcome death, because we see spirit says, how can I become prime creator? I'd have to change reality. That would destroy reality. So I have to find some way to overcome this destructivity, annihilation, in order to become prime creator. So it imagines a hypothetical scenario of saying, okay, I need to overcome something, annihilation. Let me imagine that I'm a body. Imagine that there's death, destroys the body. Let me identify with the body, and then let me find a way to destroy death, defeat it, get some chemotherapy for death. And so, of course, that keeps drawing death to you. You keep being drawn to it so you can keep working on overcoming it. So, of course, you're going to be born again in a body, someplace, somewhere, absolutely, so that you can continue trying to overcome death. That's the whole delusion. That's the whole situation that everyone's locked into. So we have to see examples of getting free of that and saying, ah, I don't need to overcome dreams. Well, why does reality need to overcome dreams? It's only because I want to be prime creator, but God's will is fixed, so I cannot become prime creator. So there's no way reality can be annihilated. So there's no need for it to try and overcome death. No need for any of it. But we're so habituated to trying to overcome death, sickness, despair, troubles of all kinds, that we keep dreaming them so we can see them and try to get a hold of them so we can try to overcome it. That's kind of like we say, where's that bully of death? I want to attack that bully of death. Where is it? Oh, there it is. Because you want to attack it and beat it and destroy it. So there it arises for you in your dreaming, in your imagining. That's how it works. And of course, this world here is like a collective dreaming. We've managed to collectively dream up a place ideal to try and overcome all these aspects of death, as it were, destruction, sickness, impermanence, decay, old age, all that stuff. So we come here, it's like a Disneyland of death here. And we don't need to come here at all. We don't need to come here at all. We don't need to stay here at all. We don't need to be here. This, just like we don't need to stay in the Disneyland of death. Now, after a while, you say, bah, I've taken all those rides. I don't want to go on those rides anymore. Stand in those lines, forget it. I'm going to walk out the gate and go someplace better. So the benefits, there's a lot of benefits from using your time rightly. And somehow I was able to get some examples of that in my own life and said, hey, I want to be like that. How can I be like that? And just every day slave away and keep trying to clarify. It's tricky, but without the motivators, who will do it? Nobody's going to do it. It's too difficult. For some reason, it's all kind of a the defense systems we have are all kind of self-reinforcing. They all reinforce each other in constantly shifting and changing and confusing And it's so difficult to recognize what's really taking place. Even though we hear it, it's still difficult. So without a lot of motivation, who's going to do it? Nobody. Nobody's going to do it without motivation. We're kidding ourselves, thinking that, we don't need motivation. Oh, yes, we do. Yes, we do. So it's helpful to have these great saviors be born into the world who showcase us. These are the benefits. And we say, wow, yeah, I like that. How do I get that? We all go, hey, how do I get that? And we all expect, you know, it's like some secret or something. How do I get that? Oh, right use of time. Right use of time is how we do it. What does that mean? It means every day you give it everything you got. It's that simple. It's that simple. It's not complicated. It's simply you wake up every day, I give it everything I got because I know there's some tremendous benefit. What is the benefit? Really. It needs to be showcased. And those who've done the work have to showcase it in some way. In this case, it may mean leaving the planet, actually. It may mean that. And people say, oh, how fortunate they were to be able to leave this planet. Yeah. Right use of time can amount to a lot of things, a lot. Tremendous benefits. Retirement benefits, amazing retirement benefits, actually. Literally, I'm looking at true retirement. I never planned for my retirement in this world at all. That's why I don't have any retirement here. I have nothing. Because I was planning to retire from existence, the cycles of existence altogether. Not just this cycle, all cycles. Permanent retirement. So I have to accept that permanent retirement. So how does it feel to be permanently retired? That's what I have to showcase. There's nowhere else for me to go at this point because I'm seeing, don't even need to kill death. I don't need to kill death. Nobody needs to kill death. Death only arises because we want to kill it. That's the only reason it arises. I want to kill old age. That arises because I want to defeat old age. I want to kill sickness, defeat sickness. Sickness arises because we want to defeat it. That's literally the cause and effect, the sequence. It's not that it comes up first and then I can try to destroy it. No, remember, we first wanted to be prime creator. It's not like the annihilation of reality suggested itself to us. No, we wanted to be prime creator, and that would necessitate the destruction of reality. And then that necessitates a hypothetical scenario of trying to figure out how can we overcome this destruction of reality. And then we think, well, how do we do it? Oh, we have to imagine that there's something vulnerable. Bodies vulnerable to being destroyed and then working on defeating that destruction, that death. So it's our desire that comes first. It's our desire to overcome death that comes first. And then death arises for us. That is the sequence, you see. And we have it backwards here. We think, no, we're put here and death is here and that's not fair and we got to defeat it. That's wrong. It's backwards. We have it backwards. We think God put us here and for a reason. No, it must be to defeat death. Again, that's completely backwards. We put ourselves here. God didn't put us here. We put ourselves here in a desire to be prime creator, to displace the prime creator. And that ends up with trying to overcome death. We don't need to overcome death because we can't displace the prime creator. We cannot. God's will is fixed. So we'll never face this situation of reality being annihilated. Never, 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 never. So we don't need to find a way to defeat death. Therefore, we don't need to call death to us. We don't need to imagine it. And if we don't need to imagine it, where is it? Where is it? In dreams, which you're doing, imagining hypotheticals, it's all hypothetical. We don't have to imagine death so we can overcome it. Why would we imagine death unless it was to overcome it, you see? Why would we imagine sickness unless it was to find a way to overcome it? We would not. But for the sake of continuity, we don't need to get rid of anything. We just need to accept the non-judgment on all dreaming. All dreaming, non-judgment, is all totally inconsequential to reality, to us, to what we are, to our identity, totally inconsequential. Not even the slightest tiny consequence whatsoever. So what is there to judge? What is there to judge? Is there some bad part of dreams that's consequential? See, if there's any exception, that means it's being judged as consequential to reality. Why else would God judge it? Why else would we need to judge it? Why else would we need to see a judgment, condemnation of it? God would be saying, hey, God would say, hey, that little dream there, that's a terrible dream. You need to stop that one because that's consequential to reality. And we'd say, ah, reality is vulnerable to dreams. See, it is vulnerable. It can be fragmented. Oh, it can be annihilated. Oh, my God, I got to overcome death. And it would just drive us back into even greater efforts to overcome death. So it's only the vision of non-exclusion, no exception, non-judgment, without exception, that reassures us, like, ah, dreams are not consequential at all. There's no dream that can ever be consequential. So reality cannot be fragmented. I don't need to work on overcoming annihilation. I can set all dreams down. And that's how we get free. Free of the cycles of birth and death, free of suffering, free of the nightmare, this long nightmare. That's how we do it. And those who see this need to accept the benefits of it. So that's something I have to keep telling myself, because I'm prone to say, you know, to say, well, I'll suffer along with everybody else. That kind of stupidity. I have to go down with the ship, so to speak. No, that's a terrible precedent. Imagine if I went down with a ship and people would say, well, he spent an entire lifetime of incredible effort, right use of time, and he got zero benefits from it. I say, we're never going to do that. Crazy. So when the Holy Spirit suggests to them, hey, you know, this is what you need to do. You need to make right use of time. They'll say, oh, no, I remember Clarity Rossi. He spent a lifetime listening to the Holy Spirit, and then at the end, he threw away all benefits and got nothing out of it. And they say, we're not going to be fooled like that. What do you think? We are fools. You see, so it's incumbent upon me to accept the benefits. Absolutely have to. It's a holy obligation. It's a totally necessary obligation. And I may take some flack for it too. People say, oh, what are you selfish, blah, 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 blah. No, that's a short-sighted viewpoint, because everybody here, of course, they're trying to overcome death. They're saying, oh, you're taking the day off, huh? You're not going to try and help us out, huh? Oh, yes, I am helping out, because I'm showing that death does not need to be overcome at all. It's our desire to overcome it that brings it up in the first place. And that there's a way to solve the continuity problem, and right use of time will clarify all this. It will help you get things right. Right now they're all backwards. You have to get it right. You have to get this whole sequence right. A simple sequence right. So I have that to look forward to. That's an obligation for me right now. And I don't have any presentiment of how it's going to go. I really don't. I really don't. I just, something must at some point, the benefits must appear at some point. They have to. The whole package, I mean, they're just, I imagine a huge package of benefits, retirement benefits. In other words, I have to say, yeah, I'm retired. I'm officially retired. Maybe I'll announce it. I'm officially retired. Retirement. Let the benefits start coming, because there's really, at the stage I'm at, there's really not much more to do other than to retire, and other than to let the benefits start coming, because I've figured it out. I've got it clear. What the answer is. So I've done it. So again, the only thing left is to start. Let the retirement benefits start calling upon him. I'm kind of like somebody who works super hard and puts all their money in the bank, all their money. They save, don't spend a dime. They just work like crazy. And then at some point they just have a fortune in the bank. And yet they're so addicted to working that they don't ever spend any of it. They don't even take any of it out. And that's not good. That's not good. They die with a fortune in the bank, you know. So I'm so used to working so hard, I have to allow myself to now start experience the benefits of that. So other people will see, oh, there are benefits. Otherwise, they'll say, he worked his whole life so hard, stressed out, and got nothing out of it. That's wrong. That is so wrong. So this is something that I've got to allow to happen. Otherwise, people will just say, useless. Why should we stress like that? And the path is stressful. It is very stressful. because it just seems like you're wandering. You can't quite get a hold of it. It just keeps slipping through your fingers. You just can't grasp it, cannot grasp it. And it's very frustrating. It's like golf. I spent 35 years trying to hit a straight drive, and it's still, it's very elusive. You kind of get it, and then it disappears, and you just can't quite get it. What's the deal? Why is it so difficult? And without motivation to keep going, you're certainly going to say, I'm wasting my time here. And if no one gets benefits from it, you say, why should I do this? There's no benefit to it. And it's so frustrating, and I'm not succeeding, and what's going on? So you just say, let me try and become a doctor and develop some medicine, and I'll attack some disease real aggressively and call it a day. Make a little bit of money, take some vacations, and then return to dust. So I know I got, from the day I was born, I was focused on saints and sages and gurus, etc. The day I was born, gravitated to them like instantly. And I said, I want to be like them. I want to be like them. Whole life I've been looking at those saints. I want to be like them. That's what I want. And it's never stopped. Even to this day, I'm still looking for those who are enlightened and say, you know, I want to keep being motivated, which is why it's super important in this world, any world, to highlight the saints, the sages, those who have figured it out, made right use of time, and accepted the benefits of that, and are free of the cycles of birth and death. It is super important, which is why I am so pessimistic about this world. One of the many, many reasons is that there's this enormous effort to demonize the true mystics, the ones who are broken free of the cycle of birth and death, to demonize them, to forget about them, to mock them, and just be completely indifferent to them, really, completely indifferent, as if indifference is a sign of intelligence. We have generations now who have been brainwashed into believing total indifference to these great motivators is the ultimate sign of progress and intelligence. They're progressives, you see, and that is disastrous. Because then people will not make right use of time. And if you don't make right use of time, what happens? You make wrong use of time. And what's wrong use of time? Doubling, tripling, quadrupling your efforts to overcome something and become super activist. And of course, the more you want to overcome something, the more you draw that something to you. The more you want to overcome whatever, the more you draw it to you. The more you want to overcome death, the more you draw death to you. And so you end up very bad situation, very bad. And that's what's going to happen in the world. The whole thing is set up like that. And those who put their attention on to the holy people who have gotten free of birth and death, all suffering, in a state of constant bliss and freedom, they are seen as archaic, vestigial dunces, you know, those who are failing to progress, and failure to progress is really is being criminalized, actually. See, that's something that we need to talk about. Failure to be progressive is being criminalized in every way possible, from every angle possible. It is being criminalized. And that their real goal is to get down and exterminate those who put their attention onto those who have succeeded in getting free of delusion. Because they feel that that's not the right way to solve the continuity problem, that the right way is to overcome death, to defeat it, to triumph. And those who are unwilling to do that, they see that they're useless. Useless, and even more than useless, they're willfully obstructionist. So that's being criminalized in many, many ways. the momentum is overwhelming in that direction of the world. The legal momentum of the planet, you have to look at that. The legal momentum of the whole planetary legal system is an avalanche towards criminalizing that. It's hard to turn the legal system around. See, that's the problem. What many don't understand is that the legal system of the globe itself has been changed. The activists and the progressives have changed the legal system of the planet in targeting a certain group of people, those who understand what salvation really is. They want to exterminate them because they feel that they're obstructionist and they're preventing success from taking place, when it's just the opposite. They're showcasing the benefits of right use of time and seeing that nothing needs to be triumphed over, nothing needs to be overcome. Dreams do not need to be triumphed over. So a legal system is very difficult to turn around the momentum in a certain direction. As we see now, it's very easy to actually push it in the direction it's going. The Shabak movement has very easily pushed the legal system to accept their demands, very easily. But it's super difficult to change direction once that this Goliath is going full blast in a certain direction. Very difficult, very difficult. It's taken a long time to subvert and change the direction of the legal system of the globe. It's taken about 100 years or so, maybe not quite that many, but close to a century of all-out effort to subvert and change the legal system of the globe to then target right use of time and demonize right use of time and criminalize it, actually, because that's not seen as being progressive towards defeating something, making something better, in other words, getting rid of what is worse. So that's the problem. When we talk about the problem of the planet, it's really the legal system. It is central to it all. Central to it, and it's very difficult to turn that around. Once it gets out of whack, once it gets off the tracks, how are you going to get a big locomotive like that back on the tracks? I mean, it's off the tracks and it's going down off the cliff right now, and so it's not possible. It's really not possible at this point to turn it around. That's not possible. Too many judges, too much ideology has taken place, and too much brainwashing, too much public support for it. It's going down the cliff. And so it's likely, again, I'd say relocation is a very strong likelihood under those conditions. This was prophesied by Jesus, saying that the righteous would be persecuted, the prophets, the saints of God would be severely persecuted in the end times, if, meaning that attitude would be there. The attitude of wanting to do that would be there. That's the attitude, which is where we're at right now. In other words, right use of time leads to freedom from birth and death, freedom from suffering, misery, and freedom from foolish activity. And the attitude is to get rid of that, get rid of it. It sets a bad example. According to the progressives, that's a very bad example for everybody else. They don't want that example to be set. See, they're very intelligent, saying, look, they want right examples for what they are doing, being activist, getting rid of stuff, triumphing. They don't want somebody who says, hey, you don't have to triumph over anything. Look at the benefits. They don't want that. Just like Barabbas didn't want Jesus around. He said, hey, you're pacifying people. You're misleading them. We want activists. You need to get rid of you. So Jesus said at the end of days, end of the cycle, that's the attitude, the legalistic attitude of the times would be to get rid of those who set the right example, actually, for the world. Because they see that as severe distraction. They don't want it. Now, that's not to say that the saints and the sages need to be persecuted or need to be destroyed. No. They can sidestep it. They can relocate, along with all those who want to continue on with right examples, relocate. So it's very important. I don't know why it's not being pointed out more by teachers around the world. Maybe they think they can win the day. I don't know. It doesn't seem very likely right now. I think that they're living in the past too much. Those days are over. Those days are over. I mean, the legal system has been changed, and we're only seeing the tip of the iceberg. The legal system that allowed some freedom and allowed positive examples to be set of right use of time, that legal system is dead. It's gone. When you talk about a new cycle, new phase, you're talking about a new legal system. You're talking about a different set of laws, different set of expectations for the law, how the law is used, what's emphasized, what is the focus of the to be prosecuted, to be persecuted and prosecuted, and what's how strong is the will of the people, you know, how much does it follow the will of the people. And of course, we have all around the world the youth revolutions. We've never had a situation where there's so many young people. Most of the world is under 30, 35, 30, but very young. Still youthful, very youthful. We have a world that is really being run by youth, essentially. We have a legal system that is going to bend it to their will. And of course, youth is inherently leans more towards progressivism, inherently. Because of all that energy, they say, hey, even if they're wise, they say, well, I got so much energy, why don't I at least tackle some of them, try to overcome and triumph over something? And so they lack this, it's difficult for them to not do that. Very difficult. That's why traditionally the elders have held positions of authority in the world, because they're much wiser and they don't have as much energy. And they say, wait a minute. Let's go a little bit easy on this triumphing thing. Let's not, you know. Look at Alexander the Great. What was he? Very young, 20s, I think, doing all that triumphing. All he could do was, I want to triumph over everything. And when he triumphed over all the kingdoms, he said, I don't want to live anymore. I have nothing more to triumph. It's that energy and enthusiasm of youth is easily pulled into that. Into those types of efforts. So I tried to triumph over death, but that only drew death to me. So I was like a walking dead person my whole life. Because people rejected the truth that I had some awareness of. And they said, well, if you want to help us do the ultimate, then try it, then we'll give you the ultimate thing that's bothering us the most. And I say, what's that? And they say, death. If you really want to be a savior of the world, you need to overcome death. So then I tried to triumph over death, which caused me to bring death to me. So I was like a walking dead person. I really was. Because I was so intense on trying to figure out how to overcome it. But conversely, when one gives up any effort to overcome death at all, or anything else, where is death then? Where is death then? Where is fatigue then? Where is tiredness then? And again, people also say, we're so tired. We're so tired of death. We're, you know, we're so tired of this. Can you help us overcome tiredness? So I brought the whole syndrome of suffering upon myself so I could try to overcome it. So I just was just suffering continuously, terribly, which now I see was a mistake, which can be remedied, which absolutely can and will be remedied. And yet the world, the progressives don't want that at all. They want examples of those who are pushing the utmost to make the world a better place, which means better than what? Better than what it was, which means what happens to what was in the waste bin, trash bin of history. And of course, what do youth feel is the something they really don't want? Old age, right? Death, old age. If we just get rid of all the old people, then there'll be no examples of old age around in the world, right? So that'll solve our problem. No examples. It's not well thought through, but underlying things is, let's get rid of the old people. We don't need old age around. They don't have anything to offer us. There's an underlying current of that too in the world. When you get too much authority in the hands of youth, the older people are very much at risk, actually. Very much, which older people understand, which is why they don't like giving up power to the youth. But these days, the youth has unprecedented power. The older people are scared of them. Parents are scared of their children. children make anything up they want to and accuse their parents of anything, the parents are in big trouble. So the youth is intimidating the older people, absolutely bullying and intimidating them at this point. And it's going to get much, much, much worse with social media and the ability of youth to rapidly mobilize. Whereas old people, no, they don't do that. I don't have a smartphone. I don't tweet. I don't do any email. I don't do the communication to anybody on social media or anything. So old people can't do that. They don't do that. It's the young people who immediately, let's get, 10,000 people at this spot right now. They can do it. They absolutely can do it easily. And so they know they have this power. And they know that older people don't have this power. So of course they're going to use that power. Absolutely going to use it. And as we see, if the older people don't do what they want, they'll topple them. Topple them, change the laws of the country, and do whatever they want to do and seize power. Seize power, really. Or put their puppets in power. So it's an unprecedented situation, very dangerous situation, because youth is a little bit out of balance. The energy of youth is such that it tends to overpower the wisdom. Even if you're born with wisdom, it's a terribly difficult thing to hold on to it. Terribly difficult, especially when all the rest of youth is pushing in a different direction. It is super difficult. So you may back away from it, but you might not have a real clarion call ability to stand up to it all. Like I was not able to stand up to it in an adamant way when I was young. I got crushed by all the peer pressure of youth saying basically, hey, if you're not for us, just shut up. Just shut up. That's what I got basically. I tried to stand up to it, but my contemporaries told me, hey, look, many of my contemporaries were activists. Absolutely. I mean, my generation was very activist. It started then. The baby boomers and the late boomers were very activist. All the war movement, the peace, the peace marches, social justice, all that stuff came out of my generation, baby boomers, and started that. And of course, I said, no, this is all wrong. This is all wrong. And they said, look, if you don't like it, then just shut up. And if you don't shut up, we're going to kill you. That's what I was told. Really, seriously. My contemporary said that, put that pressure on me. He said, we're gonna kill you if you don't shut up. So I shut up and just bottled it up and got sick. Said, wow, maybe I can try to be at least useful by overcoming something that I'll be a hero, overcome the most difficult problem, then they'll realize. Maybe they'll listen to me then. If I overcome death, maybe they'll listen to me. But of course, that only caused terrible suffering. So activists, that's what they'll say. They'll say, look, if you're not with us and you want to live, just shut up. Just go in a hole in the ground. Don't bother us. Don't get in our way. That's exactly what they do. You want to talk about bullying? That's what I experienced. So they're really atrocious bullies. Even at a young age. I mean, the spirit of activism is there, and the bullying is severe. Now, who told me this? Who threatened me? It was the women that threatened me, the women activists. And they said they will get the male activists to kill me. And I believed them, absolutely. They weren't joking. It's the men that do the dirty work. They do the slaughter. But it's the women who identify those who are not getting with the program and are trying to obstruct the activist program. They say, hey, either get in line or shut up or we'll send someone to deal with you. And it's not a joke. And for those of you who have ever experienced that, I know exactly what that's all about. They're out to kill death. So anybody who stands in their way, they'll kill them first, for sure. They think, oh, they must be pro-death because they're not trying to kill death, so we're going to kill them first. Remember, the more you try to kill death, the more you have to imagine that death is real. And the more you imagine death is real, the more potent it seems to be for you, and the more terrible the destruction you'll rain down upon your head. Because you cannot triumph over dreams. And the more you try, the worse it gets for you. So, really, but there was, I had no allies, you know. I had no allies. I was all alone. And so I couldn't stand up to him. Which is very regrettable. Very, very regrettable. But, boy, you never want to come into the world in an activist situation. In order to be helpful to the world, you need to be come into this world in an unknown place where there's no activism, where everything is very humdrum and nobody's pushing you to be an activist, and you need to mature and get older in order to find your voice, and then you can help the world. But to try and come into a situation like I did, where the activism is just so incredibly intense, Bay Area free speech movement, what's happening at Berkeley, all the anti-war protests, all the social justice, it was just a complete, incredible activist atmosphere. And here I was saying, hey everybody, this is all wrong, this is all wrong, forget it, this is going to lead to disaster eventually. They said, who are you? You're nobody, shut up. And I wouldn't shut up, so eventually they got so angry, they said, look, we're going to make you shut up if you don't shut up. And now look what's happened to the world. Activism has now infected the whole planet. And it's going to bring destruction down on its head. But the mistake I made was to put myself in a position that I did, the place that I was born and raised, etc., thinking I needed to be in that kind of sort of place among intellectuals and those who could understand. That's not true. That was my mistake. Because if you're really clear about truth, you can be born in a backwater place. Backwater. Don't even have to go to school. Don't have to go to school. Nobody has to know who you are. You can be the lowest of the low, and nobody even cares about you at all. And then later on, when you get old enough to handle yourself in all ways, then you can start introducing yourself to the world. That's the right way to go about it. But I felt I needed the status of being in this area. I thought the status of being in this area and being so educated among all these very educated people in the really the center of higher learning in the Bay Area, you know, it was a very prestigious place, that it would give me some prestige. Well, That backfired. I thought people would listen to me because of that. No, just the opposite. It was the wrong place. So, it was my own lack of clarity that was responsible for that. I don't think the Holy Spirit would advise me to do such a thing like that. I must have said, hey, I think I see a good situation for myself. That's where I'm going to go. And no. Again, like Ananda Mai, she's born in Kiora, tiny little village out in the middle of nowhere. Nobody even knows where it is. Just a few huts here and, you know, a few huts, some rice paddies, a few ponds, some jackfruit trees, and just totally rural, boondocks, rural area. And almost had no schooling hardly whatsoever, didn't know how to read or write. Nobody even worried about where she was at any particular time, because neighbors, friends would take care of you. They're like, children just wander wherever they wanted to wander. Nobody was worried about where you went or what you did, really. There's no expectations, no professional expectations whatsoever, nothing like that. So there's no pressure. And she just seemed like kind of a very, very, very sweet idiot. And so people said, oh, she's retarded, but she's so sweet, so that's okay. And then later she moved to Dhaka, you see, and when she was now a young adult, and people then could start taking her seriously, and at that point she met the intellectuals, and they said, wow, you know, she's just way beyond us. But so they didn't have a chance to intimidate her when she was young, not that they could have, but see, that's the smart way to do it. That's the right way to do it. You cannot be born into a hive of activism and when you're an infant and stand up to the activist. No way. No way. look at what Herod did to all the children when Jesus was born, supposedly. You know, said, let's kill all the children because we can't. I feel that there's this presence is here, which we cannot have this, you know, we cannot have this Jesus coming into the world. He's born in a manger, you know, in a little town of Bethlehem. No expectations. See, that's the right way. That's the right way. But the progressives, of course, they want to make sure that everybody in the world gets their education, that the education that they want them to have, no exceptions. So they don't want any place where anybody can be born in this world where the spirit of activism isn't pressed upon them from the day one, and more importantly, that they're going to monitor everybody for their attitudes and activities to make sure that there's no slackers anywhere in the world, you see, where nobody's opposing their agenda, the agenda of making better. Change, making better, improvement, triumph, overcoming, that agenda. They want to make sure there's nobody in the world that is opposed to that. Sort of an ideological iron curtain. Nobody can get out, nobody can get in. And so, they have large ambitions. Global ambition, you might call it global ambitions. You see, the ambition is different now. It's not ambition, small ambition, small town. No, it's global ambition is what's driving the planet. Global ambition. In other words, how are we going to shape the entire globe without any exception? Let's get a global curriculum, a global religion, a global economic system, a global monetary system. Everything is global now. Meaning without exception, on the entire planet, no exception. Not someplace that say, excluded. No, everybody pulled into this one system so they can control every facet of it from cradle to grave so that they can make certain that nobody showcases right use of time here and that everybody is making wrong use of time, trying to triumph over, overcome, ultimately triumph over death, which is the ego's plan of salvation. It doesn't work. And ultimately, what is the ego's plan serving? Spirit wanting to become prime creator. That's exactly what it serves. So you have this unrepent attitude. I mean, unrepentant means they haven't yet given up the desire to be prime creator. That unrepentant attitude is headquartered here in this world, has taken root and is in control of the globe, and they wanted to make this globe their own quote-unquote paradise, their own sanctuary from repentance, sanctuary from right use of time, sanctuary for the ego, an egoic sanctuary. It's where they can get everybody to work on trying to overcome stuff, you know, biotechnology, nanotechnology, technology, technology, technology. Let's triumph over everything. Let's triumph over dreams. Let's triumph over death. And they want to have total global control. That's their agenda. Whereas before, we had also smaller agendas. Let's make this area, control of this area. Let's make this little area an egoic sanctuary. Let's make this country an egoic sanctuary. Let's make the whole globe an egoic sanctuary for the egos, the unrepentant to come, for the unrepentant to come and work on trying to triumph over death. So, of course, now that it's global, it's a different game, which is why I say relocation is a very important option. It's not like there's little territories that are under egoic sanctuaries and there's other areas that are not. And no, the whole plan now is global, total. No exceptions in this planet. They don't want to make any exceptions. Just as non-judgment doesn't make any exceptions. The ego is trying to not make any exceptions for judgment. It wants to judge everything. Everything is judgeable to the ego. No exceptions. See, everything is regulated, monitored, judging. It's going to be judged. Every last thing is judged. That's what the ego, no exceptions, because the ego thinks that we have to triumph over death. We must judge it as wicked, evil, terrible. We're going to defeat it. No exceptions. See, so it's like the opposite, the inverse of God's non-judgment, no exceptions. Here we want a whole globe. The ego wants a whole globe. A global egoic sanctuary with no exceptions whatsoever. Not even one person on the planet is excluded from this. from, of course, the benefits the ego believes to bring. Everyone's going to get all the inoculations, and preventative inoculations of every last possible thing. And see, they're trying to overcome death, aren't they, and sickness. So let's take shot, medicine, pharmaceuticals. People be pumped full of pharmaceuticals, be subject to every kind of therapy and modality and mental brainwashing techniques and trying to overcome death, overcome sickness. Not realizing at all, it's their desire to overcome it that brings it about in the first place. Not realizing they want that knowledge exterminated from the planet. Which is why Jesus said it'll be a time of the severe persecution of the saints and the elect of God will be in great danger, grave danger. So relocate, of course. The legal system, the pace of the legal system, so fast, is now executive orders can be signed, and the legal system does nothing. Everyone just lays down and says, we can't defeat it. The legal system's against us. And it'll take us, they're able to drag things through the courts that'll just take decades and decades to try. And by that time, way too late. It's like the big corporations, the multinationals, they just do whatever they want to do. And if someone sues them, they'll just fight it in court for as long as possible, and then they come up to some wishy-washy verdict, maybe, and they get $1 billion fine, or whatever. But meanwhile, they have extended their control, you know, all over. They're not worried about playing by anyone's rules or laws. They break laws all the time, and they'll just say, "We'll pay the fine if we have to," but we've got a team of lawyers, and you know, legal staff will, a legal division will just delay as long as possible. And so that's how they work. That's how they operate. So of course there is this enormous difficulty in the world, and the right example has to be set. So I will see what kind of benefits come to me in the days ahead. Certainly we are. Towards the beginning of the tribulation period is at hand, really. This Pope Benedict stepping down is the signal, because the next Pope is supposedly the last Pope, the final Pope, during whose reign there will be severe tribulation, to say the least. In other words, the tribulation period will be full on. And people don't quite understand it, that it's an ideological tribulation more than anything. But the more we try to defeat conflict, the more conflict we experience. You know, the idea of the war to end all wars, that just actually brings about even worse war. It really does. The idea to defeat conflict just brings about more conflict. See, the ego's insane. It's driven by this desire to overcome death and overcome annihilation. And so this whole dreaming has that as its purpose. And it continuously doesn't understand this, never understands the remedy. It doesn't. So the more we pursue high objectives like that, the worse things get, actually. The more we progress, the more we regress. That is true. Again, the vision of non-judgment is how we solve the continuity problem. Solve the problem of all dreaming. There's no progression or regression there at all, is there? There's no progress. It's one non-judgment upon all dreams, regardless of content. So there's no issue of overcoming anything, or defeating anything, or progressing at all. None. Zero. That is the remedy. And the other remedies actually make things worse, much worse. Because how do we defeat dreams? How do dreams defeat other dreams? They don't. They don't. So the more you want to defeat death, the more intense death becomes. And you can never defeat it. And you say, and you figure, well, I haven't seen the worst of it yet, so I need to make it even worse. And that doesn't work. So you say, I need to make it even worse. And so it gets worse and worse and worse. The more you try to defeat dreams, the worse the dreams become. Because you cannot defeat dreams. It's meaningless. And again, the whole purpose is to make death real and then overcome it. And since it's a dream, it's never real. So we keep trying to say, let's make death even worse, more death, more terrible death. So give us the opportunity to make a final victory over it. So it's always this attempt to have a final victory brings even worse troubles upon, tribulations upon those who are trying to triumph. And I know people are saying like, oh wow, is this true? I'm hearing it, is this true? And for a minute you see it and you say, oh my gosh, oh, is that really true? Oh boy, yeah, it is true, it is true. But most people will just say, oh, that's scary. I don't know if I want to accept that. So, but it is true. That is absolutely true. So the benefits of recognizing the situation as it is need to be showcased and need to come about soon. People talk about, well, it's a relocation, pre-trib, mid-trib, post-trib. I don't know at this point. We'll see. But we're going to be into it coming up. This marker with the Pope stepping down, boom. Okay, we're under the gun. We are under the gun. We're going to be put under the gun. What's the gun? The legal system. Legal system. The laws that are at work. The usage of legal authority, federal authority, legal authority, all that stuff. The usage of that to push through changes, to push through activist goals, to in many, many ways, it's already very tyrannical right now. Already extraordinarily tyrannical, actually, in many, many ways. And the court systems are now supporting the activist goals. They're supportive of it. So really, resistance has already been crushed in many, many, many ways on this planet. Crushed. And the will to try and fight against it legally again is being crushed. Which is why the problems in the world could be heading towards civil war, world wars, because once people realize that there's no way for redress in the courts, then what are they going to do, you see? What are they going to do? They recognize, uh-oh, we can't win in the courts. It's impossible. Or it's just a delaying game and it's too late. Then they're going to start getting more activists themselves. So you have activists fighting activists in this world. You see, activists don't always agree. As a matter of fact, they're very factionalized. If you, the more activist situation comes, the more fragmented it becomes. You have, because since it's impossible to defeat dreams, triumph over them, everyone has their own opinion of how to do it, because they can look at someone else and say, well, your way failed. And they say, hey, I got an opportunity to be a hero here. I think I have the answer. And then someone else says, no, I tried your way, it fails too. And they said, no, you're lying. And then there's all this infighting within activism, all this infighting, fragmentation. It goes towards chaos. Goes towards chaos, actually. And so you have activists on different sides, different ideas of how to triumph. And they'll be at each other's throats. When the legal system supports one more than the other, and the other realizes that it can't succeed through the legal system, then you start having troubles. You really start having troubles. The legal system was set up in the United States and in many places to kind of keep checks and balances in place between activists. So no side tends to dominate the other too much. It's a two-party system, right? But what's happened now is that two-party system has, it's essentially over, really, because of the court system and the way things are set up now is the Progressive Party has really triumphed over the Conservative Party. And conservative activists, they're activists too. Progressives are activists, conservatives are activists, both are activists. The conservatives say, our activism in the past, that's what's going to work, so let's stick with it. And the progressives say, no, we have a better idea. We're thinking more globally, because the activists in the past didn't think as globally to a lesser extent. And so they got their wealth, their power that way. And now new activists come in and say, hey, we have a bigger idea of activism, so you need to get out of the way. So really you have a battle between two sets of activists. Between the progressives and conservatives. They're both activists. But the thing is, the conservatives have lost the power of the court system, legal system now. So they're defeated, essentially. And they realize they're defeated. Well, that's could lead to real trouble. Because they're used to telling everybody what to do. And now you have a new group of people say, no, we're gonna tell everybody what to do. And that's a bad recipe right there. And then you have other activists around the globe, huge amount of activists who feel they're entitled to tell everybody else what to do. And so you get a recipe for disaster. And the legal system seems to be overpowered right now. Overpowered, making decisions just to save their own necks, so to speak. They're not saying, hey, we're the ultimate power and our job is to keep the checks and balances between these different factions. Let's not let anyone feel too disempowered. If you get a large faction feeling disempowered through courts and no power, that leads to civil war, revolution, etc., as you see throughout history. So that's the problem where the progressives have rigged the courts, the legal system too much, and too much power, and they want to crush the other activists to such an extent that it's a very unstable situation, actually. Very unstable. But again, we're not. What I'm saying is, don't be an activist at all. And both sides don't like that. Both sides hate that. They say, "What are you talking about? No, you're crazy. We got to triumph. It's just our ideas of triumphing are better than their ideas. So which side do you support?" They say, "Neither side. I don't support any activism. I support deactivism. Deactivate, non-judgment of dreams. No triumph over dreams. Don't need to triumph." So. The world is full of activists right now, of all types, races, religions, everyone's on the move. Everyone's trying to seize as much power as they can. It's a massive power grab. As the United States power is surrendered, there's a massive vacuum in the world. And of course, nature abhors a vacuum. So there's a tremendous rush for everyone to grab as much power as they can. The U.S. is no longer looked up to as the big bully on the block and keeping everybody in check. It's been shown over and over and over and over again now the United States has surrendered its position in that way. And the world is very much aware of that. So they say, hey, let's just go for it. Let's have a revolution in our country. The U.S. is not going to stop it. Or they're going to fight on the side of the rebels. It seems like no matter what happens, any time a revolution starts, the U.S. is going to support the rebels no matter what, because it's the youth movement again. The demographics of the progressives, in order to stay in power, they have to cater to the youth, and cater to that ideology of rapid change, support the youth. And they know, hey, if we want to stay in power for a long period of time, we have to side with youth, okay, have to do it. So the conservatives appeal to older people, generally, progressives to youth, because the progressives, their goal is to stay in power permanently. And so in order to do that, they have to get the youth supporting them. And so when these revolutions break out, they say, hey, we support the young rebels, no matter what. And so the rebels, young rebels, have realized that, hey, we can do whatever we want to. Got carte blanche. The U.S. is not going to stop it. Whereas in the past, it was the opposite. The conservatives had more power. The older people had more power. And revolutions in places of the world, they would side with the older generation and put the youth revolts down. See, different story. Now it's backwards. It's opposite of that. So the revolution, the global revolution, is being empowered, greatly empowered by the circumstances right now. The demographics of the planet are such that it favors what is to come. So, again, to round it out, accept the benefits of right use of time. maximum acceptance of the benefits of right use of time right now, so that you can maximize your avoidance of this factionalism, activist. You can sidestep activism. Really, essentially, that's what you're sidestepping is activism. Of all types, of all types. And sidestep it is to the ultimate extent that you can, because it's really useless. It's completely wrong use of time, utterly useless. Has no benefit to anybody. Totally useless. Active, all this change, trying to change, totally useless. Totally useless. Trying to make things better, totally useless. Instead, accept the blessing of non-judgment upon all dreams, without any exception, and without any judgment upon any form or content the dream pretends to have, because dreams don't have any real content at all. They're just mirages, imaginary, no reality to them whatsoever. So they're really empty, devoid of meaning or content entirely. So why should God judge amongst those? We would say, oh, God must be crazy to judge amongst those. No. And so we need to be reminded that God is still God. God's will is fixed, and reality is fixed. Its will is fixed. It's inviolate. It's whole. It's one. Can never be fragmented. It can never be annihilated. There's no necessity to dreaming. No necessity to hypotheticals. We need to be just simply reminded of that fact. That's all. That's all we need to do is be reminded of that fact. And whereas the activists want to do everything possible to not be reminded of that fact, which is why we need to sidestep them at this point. It doesn't help them any to not be reminded. It doesn't help them at all. They too, at some point, need to be motivated to do turn it around and pursue a clarification and make right use of time. And in order to do that, they, of course, need to have role models, examples they can point to and say, ah, yeah, okay, right use of time, look at the benefits, okay, let's do it. So, but right at this point, we may have to realize that temporarily they may not be interested in that, which is okay. That's okay. Not a problem. Don't push the river. They'll have their time. They'll get sick of it. They'll get sick of trying to triumph over dreams. And they'll say, ah, there must be a better way. There must be a better way. And then they'll be receptive to motivation at that point. So those who can have to keep themselves viable for that, to provide the right examples, to show the benefits, show the benefits of right use of time when the receptivity is actually eventually there. And so it's very important that the activists not trample down those who not. It's very important they don't convince those who have the benefits coming to them not to accept them. It's very important for the activists. Very important, so they don't think later on another cycle they say, hey, you know, I was able to convince them not to get any benefits, and so I don't want that to happen to me. And so I don't want to make right use of time because someone's going to come along, convince me not to have them, and it just sets a whole negative spiral going in their mind, and so it delays things very badly. So again, I may have to get out of Dodge simply out of compassion and right use of time for the sake of those who don't know how to use their time rightly. It'd be very, very bad for them to convince anyone not to accept the benefits of the right use of time. It's very short-sighted of them, very short-sighted. In the big picture, it's super important to have those examples as motivation, because everyone engaged in activism, at some point they're going to set it down and say, wow, this just doesn't work. It works. Please show me what works. Show me the examples of who's done this. I really am desperate for it. Desperate, desperate, desperate. Yeah, at some point they'll be desperate for it. And then you'll be able to say, hey, yeah, I got all the benefits back then, when, and I was able to use the right use of time in the face of all these troubles, and you can do it too. I know you can do it. And then to provide the right example, show the benefits, and they'll say, okay, let's try. It's worth it. It's worth it, all out effort. All right, so we'll see. We'll see what happens. I don't know what's going to happen. I've not been told. I've not gotten exactly anything concrete at all of what kind of benefits will come to me. So that should be interesting to find out. And the world may not even know. Actually, again, probably it'd be more useful at some other time, other place, where aspects of spirit are continuing to try and triumph over death. At that time and place, then the benefits can be showcased better. That's possible. Or they could showcase here for a while. I don't know. That's possible too. Or both. And it could come soon. It could come soon if I can kind of smoothly segue into it. Say, okay, I'll start showcasing the benefits here. The only difficulty is, like, I was treated so rudely by the activists that there's a feeling like, why should I help them? You know, that kind of thing. But the truth is that they deserve to be helped just as much as anyone else, because they're going to need to do this right use of time eventually. So we might as well set the seeds for that. Might as well set the seeds, you know. Any trouble I had really was because of my own lack of clarity. And I was not, my roots were not deep enough. So I was able to be pressured into trying to triumph over death. So I have to get to that point. Yeah, everybody deserves it. Everybody deserves it. And then it will come, because you can't hide the benefits. If you let these benefits out, everybody's going to have an opportunity. It's going to be felt. And you'll have everyone on the planet's very activist, really. So everybody that here come will feel the benefits. They're activists, and they may want to use it to fire them their own activism up, but that doesn't really work. I just can't have Barabbas, do his thing. That's not acceptable at this point. If it gets to that, relocation for sure. That's not helpful at this point at all. We need to see the benefits again. Benefits of right use of time. Benefits that people can say, ah, that's what I really want. I mean, do we really want to be crucified? Absolutely not. Why is that some kind of benefit? Why do people say, oh, I really, really want to spend my whole life, right use of time, and work so hard just so I can be tortured and crucified? Oh, yeah, that's really makes a whole lot of sense. No, it doesn't. That's what happens. That should be an example of what happens when wrong use of time. Wrong use of time. Right? That's what happens. The more you want to overcome death, the more you crucify yourself. That is true. The more you want triumph over death, the more you draw crucifixion to yourself. And you'll crucify your body, brutalize it, torture their body, just because you want to draw death so close to you, so intensely, so you can then grab it. As death is torturing you and killing you, you think, okay, he's so close to death, so now I'm going to pounce on it. Get it, got it, I got it. Where is it? I know I got it now. Oh, it slipped away. Well, I thought I had it. Like that. So they say Jesus on the cross, he's all tortured, he's all bloody, he's all nailed to the cross, he's dying, and they're saying, okay, we got it, it's right there, now we're going to pounce on it. Now, how can you pounce on a dream? How can you pounce on a phantom? How can imagination pounce on itself? Pounce on a figment of its own imagination? Cannot. So it's all a waste of time. All right. Not sure how to use the rest of the day, but I don't know. Right use of time. It's not always easy. It's not always easy, but benefits. Okay, I'll work on letting the benefits come. Okay, we'll see how that goes. That's the new phase now. For you, for me, for everyone. Allow the benefits of right use of time to come. Just the benefit, all the benefits that you've accrued, whatever it is. Maybe you've just used a few days right. Maybe some months, some years. Maybe you used the right use of time a lot. Or very intensely over a shorter period. Allow those benefits to come to you now. Allow them to come right now and say, okay, I'm going to let those come into my life and lift my life up to whatever extent that they can. And at least do that. It's like a tsunami's coming. You say, okay, let me get a run as quickly as I can to some higher ground. And some might have a hilltop they're close to. Others a little less high ground. But try to get to higher ground right now. Let yourself be lifted up to higher ground. Let the benefits of right use of time lift you up to higher ground right now. Okay. Very great. That's it for this one.